Hello and welcome to episode 157 of the Foundry Roundtable, the podcast exclusively covering the Foundry for Star Trek Online. And we are back after sort of a couple weeks off from our regular episodes. We first, of course, did the a run of the Arena of Sompek. That was a lot of fun. And then Dragoon was off, hopefully not falling into the Grand Canyon.
Almost.
But now he's back. Almost, not quite. A harrowing adventure, perhaps.
Only fell down a little bit.
Well, I mean, the cyborg ninja assassins made a good attempt at it, but I mean...
Oh, well.
They just, you don't get what you pay for anymore these days.
Well, in any case, Dragoon is back with us, and of course, I am your Tame Foundry author, Drogyn1701, and with us are our usual co-hosts, Markhawkman and DuncanIdaho.
Hello, hello.
Hello. How are you doing?
I do appreciate that Mark has Jeff Captain.
So, as you can see, we are on a Foundry map here, which Duncan has made for us. So let's get started with you telling us what's up here.
So this is a complete, well, not complete, but this is a custom ship interior for the USS Sierra, a Sovereign class starship, which is where you get your briefing in my next mission that I did talk about a little bit before the show and kind of spoiled for anyone who is listening. But this is going to be the first map of my upcoming Enterprise B themed mission. So we've got a few rooms here. We've got a bridge. I've hooked them up. Normally you'll be turbo lifting up and down to the bridge, so to speak. But for tonight, I've just hooked up some doors so we don't have to all crowd in.
Apparently you also have a bully and bartender.
I do have a bully and bartender. I also have a kitty. Kitty on the bar.
Mm-hmm. That's not very sanitary.
Nope. But it's the future. They've got scrubbers. Or unless it's a holographic kitty. So this started life way back. Just started like, you know, I want to build a mission about a ship. And then it's like, well, I'm going to build a time travel mission, which also involves a ship. And then it's like, well, I'm going to make a mission about a ship that's from a different timeline, and it's not going to be this ship. So I've wound up with a detailed interior map with no practical use right now as the sort of centerpiece, so I'm just going to be using it for the briefing. So, a lot of stuff. This is a little botanical lab. Do not pet the tribbles, because that does end the mission. But what I've actually done with this one is that I've used chandelier pieces to set up the little containers. And then the walls are a combination of the standard Starfleet walls, which I've actually lowered to get the nice detailing around the edge of the ceiling. But I've also inset these Klingon light pieces just to kind of give the idea that there's maybe a little bit more going on. Maybe these are a bit shelving units and there's plants inside.
Yeah, actually, what they kind of remind me of is those like padded panels that you would see in TNG.
Oh,
like on the bridge along the side.
That is good. Yeah.
I got to remember that to do.
Of course, well, you totally intended for that the entire time. Okay.
Yes, exactly. Except I only used them in the botanical lab.
Well, one thing that's kind of weird about those new Romulus plants is the fact that they are constantly moving like they're in a high wind, even when they're not.
Yeah. That they're moving under muscle power in here. They're alive.
Don't worry. They're only slightly sentient.
they're waiting for you to get too close so they can eat you.
Let us go. Freedom. So, that's just an elevator. So that's actually an easy way to end a hallway without having to build a lab or things. Is just like, yeah, I'm just going to end in an elevator. So your sick bay. And
I like the use of the banners from Utopia Planitia as
drapes. That's kind of nice.
Curtains.
Yeah. So that was something I learned to do in a previous mission to sort of like have a little kind of a nicer, cozier feeling to sickbay rather than just sort of like austere walls and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I've got my Zero reference in here for this mission.
I think we should just call her the emergency foundry hologram or something.
this case, she's Dr. Zero taking care of a sick Epo, and there's a couple of concerned Epos watching.
Oh, she's healing her elbow friend.
Dr. Zero is the ship veterinarian. Or, I don't know, Xeno Veterinary Technician for a more technical sounding title.
Also sounds like a mix. It sounds like the Xeno Veterinary Technician would also make upgrades.
Well, one thought that occurs to me is that I don't remember in the TV show, at least not TNG, them actually having a separate veterinarian on the ship.
Yeah, but that was also a really big ship that we saw very little of.
Yeah, so this is a little holodeck, optional dialogue thing. And this would be a turbo lift normally up to the bridge. And just, here's the bridge.
Just do like a flip-flop? Where you have
standard flip-flop and then flip-flop back to get it back downstairs. Although I might not, I might just have the one trip up this time around since I actually don't need to go back down with the new way I'll be staging this map. So the one thing I've actually started doing on this build is to actually angle consoles slightly into each other to kind of create a little bit of a curving effect. Does take a lot of trial and error to get the actual screens not to sort of like jar on top of each other, but on this one in particular,
okay,
I do like how this turned out. Yeah, so these are actually four consoles right at the top here. Two of which are angled and two of which are flat. And I've used a little bit of symmetry and I'm surprised with how well these ones turned out because you can notice where the pattern repeats, but like where exactly did they come into contact? It's like, oh, you got to look at it for a second.
Yeah. I mean, I think you could take it even further and like have an even subtler increments.
I'm out of assets.
Oh, okay. Never mind.
See all these small little lighting objects on the ceiling? Yeah, that took some work. And then, I've got lots of curved stuff. And we still haven't gotten to the resident. Oh,
lots of carpets. And
crew quarters?
and you know, I'm sure I don't have to point it out, but I will anyway, because that's what people always do. You have the wrong Master Systems display. Because there is no one for Sovereign that's available.
Yeah, exactly.
He does the same thing I do, and is pick whatever's close.
Yeah, close enough. And I did really like having that big thing back there.
Oh yeah, no, it's great.
Yeah,
This is the MSD for an Odyssey.
Mm-hmm.
What you should do is you should have an officer standing right here looking at it, and an optional dialogue. You go up to the officer.
There's your journey.
Yeah, you cut out there for a second.
Why don't you have... Am I back?
Yeah, you're back.
Hello?
Sort of. Back?
Okay. I don't know why that cut out. Strange. It's possible my broken headphones might finally be going.
I like the way you made this glass wall here, because you took those little like vertical strips and just like set several of them side by side.
Yeah, so, and sunk them down so you don't have the logo. So the idea on that one is, A, it's a nice feature, and B, the sort of the technical side is like, what if they polarize that to hide the displays in the background while they're taunting the villain? So we can have all these master displays, and like, oh yeah, you can't see where we're damaged and how exactly. So, a little bit of thinking about how starships might be designed, but... As far as everything else goes here, it's basically like, yeah, it looks cool.
Actually, a good idea.
And of course, I used the that one console group, which now is a massive lighting source too. But that one console group for that stationary static view screen.
So it's kind of like the opposite of what Aaron does, where he has his bridge officers running around like they're in a panic, even though there's absolutely nothing wrong with his ship.
Well, for Aaron's ship, it can explode at any moment. It is always panic time. Yeah.
You now have me wonder if anyone's actually ever tried to recreate the Enterprise E bridge from the movies.
Oh, yeah. I kind of had a thought like early on, like, well, I might actually try to do that. But then I realized how many assets I had to play with. And I'm like, no.
No, that's something you start with.
I think in this case, you're definitely better off just trying to do your own.
Yeah. And there's nothing to say that bridges are even in the same class that ships are carbon copies of each other.
Yeah, especially like, you know, 30 years on, too. So there's one more section to the ship. And then I did build out crew quarters.
Which way are
we
going? Uh-oh. Hold on a second. They're all going the wrong way.
just a sec. Oh, I'm just having to extract the cat from back of the monitor because she was a little playing around with the HDMI cable and my monitor went black.
Oh, that's not a good sign.
Little kitty, no!
Don't unplug the flux capacitor. No!
There are times I miss having a cat, and then there are times I don't.
Yeah. So
there are some things here in this map that are good lessons for people, which is, you know, ways to kind of break up the hallways and make them not just straight, you know, rectangles. You've got little cutouts here that are angled, and you've got, you know, sometimes you use different pillars and areas with couches and all kinds of different things.
Yeah, and just the angling thing I learned on this map is a really great way to sort of make the map feel a little bit better. I think they're all in. Yeah, we're over here in this room. Yeah, that one is the other one. This is what I'm sort of most proud of the entire map. I have finally added a bathroom to Star Trek. But the funny thing is that I found this as a glitch, but I'm leaving it in intentionally. You cannot actually fit into the toilet. You still cannot go to the bathroom.
No.
No matter how much you try, it's within reach, but no, you can never get there.
So I guess this little plastic thingy over here is the shower.
I was actually like, this is a combined shower toilet thing. This is actually a little tailor area. So idea is just holographic stuff, and then you've got your lockers there.
Interesting.
So. Yep, so that was one of the earlier parts of the build, and it's kept on. It's like, oh, I've got delete assets on the map. No, I can't lose the bathroom. Gotta keep the bathroom. And then this is an additional quarters for someone who doesn't have to sleep. Originally, it's going to be an android, but he's moved on to be a different part of the project. But I'm keeping this as is.
Maybe it's a photonic.
Yes. I'm going to guess Vulcan because I can't visualize anyone else who would like furniture this ugly.
What assets are these?
This one?
Yeah.
It's store shelving. So it's
quite odd looking.
And I placed it here. It's like, now I'm just thinking like, I got to just start building walls out of these. Just completely just like put them in sequence on top of each other. Especially with like a bright light source coming through the other side. I'm just thinking of like a smaller map. Such as distant future maps. Crap, I just realized I still got to move this monitor forward because you notice how the wall's kind of eating it up.
Oh, you mean the little thing that bisects it in the middle, huh?
Yeah, that thing.
I assumed that was intentional.
Nope, not that time.
Yeah, you wouldn't have to move it too far.
Yeah, it's one of those things where you just sort of test the map, come in, come out, and then you just sort of like, okay, I got to do this, this, and this, and you start working on this, this, and this, and some things slip. Although I will say the hardest thing to do is actually out here, back towards the, it's just the entryway to the, this. You notice that the door itself doesn't actually come flush with the ceiling. What I had to do is that I had to layer multiple of the closed fixed door pieces just so the logo doesn't show. And at the very end, I had to give up and basically cover it up with a building block. But that was close enough to the ceiling where it looks like a feature.
Hmm.
Yeah. Downside of this, though, is that there isn't a bottom to this door, so you can see through the
geometry
if you look directly below it.
Hopefully, people won't be standing in the doors too long, though.
No. Only anal compulsive Foundry authors will notice.
Ah, yeah. It was nicer, though, than the other option, which was to bring the wall pieces down, because the way I structured this doorway was actually kind of originally anticipating that it would be flush with the wall or flush with the ceiling, but then that ended up being a little bit higher. So I had to look for workarounds that still allowed me to have this structure of wall that wouldn't, like, all of a sudden start getting cut off by weird miscellaneous walls from above. Yeah, I also finally built a ground scale ship, ship map that actually uses one of the large ground scale ships to give the idea that you're actually on a vessel. Because I did that with Starbase Magellan, but I haven't done that with a ship map yet.
Looks good though.
So who's Toran?
He's one of the. These are two of the main characters in. Or Toran's a supporting character. Zacius is a main character. But Toran is a Romulan photonic. He is the butler slash assistant slash adjutant of Zacius Havoc. So that'll be fun to ride. Kind of like Jeeves, if Jeeves had knuckle dusters and knew how to hurt people.
Fun.
Kind of surprised the Romulans would bother to give their hologram sentience.
There's a personal story behind this. Because he kind of, you know, basically kind of Alfred and Batman.
Mm-hmm. Well, some versions of Alfred are a bit more interesting than others. Because I remember one version who shot several people because they were trespassing in Wayne Manor. Not fatally, mind you, but still.
Yeah. Also, her point here is that I had this character is actually based on my Delta recruit. I've been working on him for a while. There's been like short stories with Zacius that I've written last year. And I was like, I'll eventually get him in a Foundry mission. And I'm finally doing it. Imposta.
All right. Well, obviously, this is what you've been working on. So, Dragoon's been on vacation.
Yeah.
Probably has not done much in the way of Foundry. I've been kind of down with a cold. And the sitting upright position doesn't really feel very good when you have the kind of cold I had, because the congestion starts to collect when you do that. It's like you can't breathe. And obviously the breach event is on, so got to do that. Got to get that nice pink rock, you know.
Yep.
Ooh, we got a nice new set of kitchen steak knives.
Yeah, and actually, you know, I have a character that is sort of, you know, I RP as a Voth, you know, using the Voth ships and the armor from the rep and all that. So, you know, got to get those melee ones for him, right?
Absolutely.
Sounds like a plan.
Yeah.
Also, the breach is currently the quickest and easiest way to get the new Lucari marks.
Also true.
Yeah, I've been stockpiling pretty well on those guys. I've been working, since the last show, I've been actually flopping between a lot of stuff. So on this map, I just finished it. I was also working on a little bit for Epoch, and I've also started to revamp a older Starfleet security mission completely. So I'm completely rewriting it from the ground up.
Well, I actually did some tinkering over the last few days, because I finally went and changed part of the Darkness Between the Stars where it uses a move to trigger in space so that it does not actually use a move to location trigger anymore.
Those are a little iffy in space sometimes.
Well, yeah, that was the problem, is that people have always or had been having with it, is that they would keep doing the fight and somehow ending up inside the move to location trigger, which would cause the move to location trigger to not do anything.
Mm-hmm. One of the reasons
I don't really understand that glitch, but it's annoying.
Well, because, I mean, they would use or be flying around for the previous objective, and that would take them inside that reach marker when it turned over to that objective, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, reach markers, they won't trigger if you're already inside them unless you move out and back in. and I think it works the same for space, right?
Well, it's just one of those things that's never really made a whole lot of sense to me. It's just like one of those. Apparently, the way it works is it only checks when you enter the sphere thing. It doesn't check it any other time.
Yeah.
Don't understand that.
The trigger only works if you move from a point which is not the reach marker to the reach marker. So if the reach marker is already there to begin with, it probably, you know, just for some reason, it just doesn't flip that particular trigger. So it's always something to avoid and think about.
I guess when they coded it, they just didn't expect people to start inside the reach marker.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's kind of how...
You're better off.
I should say, it's kind of how computer events tend to work, is it fires a lot of...
What I did was, conceptually for this, you're supposed to be scanning the ship, so I added an invisible object that you interact with instead of having you simply go to the location.
Yeah, I've done a bunch of those too, flip-flop between them. Sometimes going to a location, but it always depends on what the proximity is. If they're always, you know, the player's close, I'll generally just use that technique of having them interact with something, especially if it's instantaneous, because that's pretty easy too.
Another thing is that I had like one guy... go in and tell me, hey, this is broken. I can't play it. One star. So I made this change and I sent him an in-game mail and telling him I fixed it. And he's like, yay, good job. And it works. Actually, apparently he actually liked the mission after I made those changes to it. This is cool.
Yeah, the last review I got of that was when the Foundry went down last unexpectedly and people started getting their characters trapped. I got a negative review for that, and they still haven't fixed it. I don't know if they ever will try going back to it if they care at this point, but...
So I can tell you something that I was working on actually earlier today. Because Dragoon got me thinking about the 26th century. As a setting for Foundry missions, because we're getting a lot of ships specifically from that era being put in the game. So I was thinking of, you know, could you make an interesting bridge or something out of the new Khitomer interior?
Ooh, the new kit one.
Mm-hmm.
I think you
could. I'm sure the answer is yes. I was just playing around with it a little bit of you know, could I raise the floor in that main area and use some of the upper tier parts of it as kind of the outer walls? And I discovered that the there's a couple of upper tiers of what are probably benches that are just meant to be seen from the ground. So when you actually get up there, there's some missing areas of geometry. naturally, because, you know, don't build what you don't need, right? But I think there's definitely some potential there. It's got, you know, great big windows and some interesting spaces and some hallways off to the side that you could use for things, you know, to make it a ship.
Yeah, as cool. Also thinking about the entry area, too, because the Odyssey introduced the idea of having transporters on the bridge, which is a pretty good idea. So I'm just thinking, especially with the fact that they've got that large circular console, they can use that to some pretty good effect for bridge officer stuff.
Mm-hmm. Now, there was a glitch on that map where it's missing a floor in that section, but obviously we can put in our own floor. So.
Yeah, that's good.
That's not too big a deal.
I don't know
why. I don't know why that would happen, but you know, it happened.
Well, it happened the same update that we started losing some of the pieces on the grating, the civilian generator gratings.
Yeah,
those are now hollow.
This is kind of strange glitches that happen sometimes.
Yeah, there's currently one in the Neverwinter Foundry where all of the asset database functions aren't working, so it just gives you this blank list of things to place on the map.
Ooh.
Yeah, it's really bad. You can't actually add objects to maps at the moment. You can duplicate existing objects that you've already placed on the map, but that's about as far as you can go. You can't actually change anything like that, because... Yeah.
That's weird.
Aw.
So anyway, I definitely think there's some potential there. We'll get to some other 26th century stuff a little bit later, because at the moment I want to let people know that I'm going to prepare to start another Foundry challenge.
Yay!
Yay!
Wow!
Because they're fun and it gets people going. And so what I want to ask you guys about is I think the last one we did 5 weeks. Is that right?
For I building? Believe, yeah, I believe so. I got done in 3 to 4 weeks, and mm-hmm. then I think 5 was the submission date.
Something like that.
That's not counting the months of lead up time that we had while we were voting on everything.
And this one won't require that. It'll basically start off with a little dev log, and I'll have maybe like one costume that people can use if they want. But otherwise it will be, you know, just that and bam, go. So it won't have to have any of that, you know, months of voting and all that kind of stuff, which was fun, but time consuming. And then, like 2 weeks of voting
or, you know,
playing and voting.
2 weeks, would be plenty of time. Especially since, like, it accommodates the fact that sometimes people have a busy weekend, so you get those two in there. Mm-hmm. So that sounds pretty good.
And let's see what else goes along with that.
I'm not building a mission for it.
No, obviously.
Nope.
Last time we had started the challenge before we invited you to join the show, and you had already started building, so we let you go ahead with it.
Yeah,
obviously, you're prohibited.
Yeah. Last time I built 3 missions before we even started the challenge.
I think last time the only one I was prepared to exclude was myself, because I kind of spearheaded the whole thing. But you were the only one of us who wanted to build a mission anyway.
Yeah, because I was like, oh, well, I want to finish some stuff off, so I want to pay off some stuff in that mission. Like, oh, so I'll just build this crazy thing and, yeah.
But I'll tell you, we really got just an absolute, you know, bunch of quality missions. I mean, really, they were all very good.
Yeah, and 3-star tail, defense mechanisms. Just the whole bunch. I'm just kind of, I wanted to give a shout out again to Starfar Thetis 1, but I forgot the title. In silence. And then silence. Mark's had a fun run, too. And we do have new AEI missions coming out too.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, good.
And more than just built by me.
I just thought of a question. Do you remember what century the outfit my bridge officer is wearing is from? Because I remember it's referred to as like alternate future or something, but I don't remember exactly.
Alternate future is in the next generation one, or your bridge officer. Okay. That one. Oh, the comm badge is from the Voyager finale and next generation finale.
Yeah. So and whenever they needed a future time period, in the shows, they would use it.
What's the jacket, the one, though? Because I remember it says something like the alternate future variant or something.
The alternate future is only for the badge. The jacket itself is Jupiter.
That is?
Yeah, that's Jupiter.
Yeah, well, and there's a couple of alternating... there's a couple of alternate versions of each Jupiter one. You know, and there's one with gold shoulders, there's one with silver shoulders, there's one with no shoulders.
If you have a legendary or have a subscription or veteran stuff. Otherwise, you don't get those.
Lucky in Foundry.
Yeah, in the Foundry you do. Mm-hmm. The normal non-scribers like myself, or non-lifetime, we don't get those.
Mm.
So, speaking of futures and alternates and things, let's talk about the 26th century. Obviously, the most recent thing we just got in game was the big promotion for the 26th century Dreadnoughts. Got a KDF one, a Romulan one, and of course the Universe class, the Enterprise J, which apparently is not at all scaled down from the one that they used in the Days of Doom queue.
Yeah, I was surprised by that. I just assumed that, you know, they got to do that. It's like, nope, it's properly scaled.
Well, you know, the funny thing is, I mean, they have caught so much flack before for times when people have thought that they were off scale that they just, I think, have decided to play as much to actual scale as they can.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's it's pretty nifty. Although it is surprising, though, that I did happen to, the first time I saw one of those, it was parked next to a Vomf Iconian battlecruiser. And yeah, it's kind of about the same size, except one's vertical, the other is horizontal. So, I mean, they're big ships, but they sort of look bigger than they are. I mean, that's kind of
we've already had sort of super big ships in the game as well.
Yeah, the art like really the plays into it.
Well, I think I feel the need to point out here is that since it exists in the game, someone will fly it in the breach.
I've already seen one. Yeah.
Yeah. And they've when they were testing these ships, they flew 5 through the breach, and it surprisingly worked out okay.
And let's see, ZE Films did one video where he flew his Enterprise J through the breach, and it worked, you know.
I posted a screenshot on the forum somewhere.
The one of the nebula?
No, this picture is me flying a Krynum science ship. And someone else, that just like a random person I saw in the breach pug, flying their universe class ship through one of those little like hallway things in the Voth fortress ship.
I want to see. I really want to see 4 of the Romulan ones, just sort of like stop, angle up, and just try to make a door for the 5th person. Like, you cannot get through.
You shall not pass.
Quick, we need to seal this hull breach.
those are kind of the first KDF and Romulan ships we've gotten from the 26th century, but we've also gotten, with Agents of Yesterday, 4 other Federation ships for the 26th century.
Oh, and I really
smaller ones, obviously, but you know, in the same design philosophy. So, you know, we have kind of a little fleet of Federation ships. Now, unfortunately, none of these are in the Foundry yet, but we get ships fairly regularly, so I'm assuming that we will get them. So, you know, there's another era that you could set missions in, which could be quite cool.
Yeah, that's true.
And I looked up what sort of canon stuff was going on in the 26th century that we know about from the shows, and the answer is not much.
Yeah.
Apparently,
they didn't touch on it that much.
You can maybe speculate, because of the Enterprise J's mission role, that they're probably looking into Andromeda. So you would probably think that if they're investing in sending the flagship out that way, there's probably not as much exploration to be done in the Milky Way.
The funny thing is that when I was looking it up, you know, what came up was the Kelvins were from Andromeda.
Yep.
Oh, isn't there supposed to be something coming around?
Okay, so, and I haven't watched this episode in a long, long, long time, but what I was reading is that they essentially sent an automated ship back to the Andromeda galaxy at the end of that episode. And it should be arriving in the 26th century.
So it should be getting back to the Andromeda or back from?
Yeah. Getting back to.
Back to,
but my thought was, you know, what if the Andromedans show up? You know, they didn't you know, maybe they didn't hear from their little expeditionary party that was in that episode. And so they sent a big generational ship, and now it's finally here.
Hmm.
Also, maybe they're not happy with us.
They weren't exactly like desperate to find a place to relocate to, you know, within the next 100 years or something like that. But they did kind of sort of have that sort of refugee thing going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that also other species too, not just the Kelvins. Yeah. Andromeda is full size galaxy. So,
and the whole thing is slowly becoming uninhabitable.
Yeah.
So isn't maybe Andromeda galaxy also where the Iconians were supposed to be hanging out?
Yeah.
That this is one of those little story things that's like, huh. Put two and two together, you wonder if they're trying to wipe out the locals.
Yeah. Or something comes up later that the Iconians could screw something up.
Well, think about it. How long have the Iconians been in the Andromeda galaxy?
A few hundred thousand years.
Many thousands of years, yeah.
Yeah, apparently that's where they gated to when they left their homeworld in that mission. Yeah.
Well, no, they gated to Dewa 3. But then they left it later.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's the one question, though, is kind of like what the Iconians would do from this point on. So I don't think they'd probably look at exterminating life in Andromeda, but they do have a lot of technology, particularly the Omega particles, that do leave the question open of something else could go wrong. So maybe there's a crisis in Andromeda.
Here's a thought as well. What if the Kelvins showing up means that you need to go to the surviving Iconians for help?
Well, see, because one of the thoughts that I had was that maybe the whole thing with the galaxy becoming radioactive, it's something that the Iconians set in motion a long time ago, but they're not directly in control of.
Could be.
But it's still questionable, like, why kill everything? That's kind of
well, like, you know, obviously that's up to you to make up, you know.
I mean, well why
if you were making a mission about it.
Well, why would they jury-rig the Iconian gate on Dewa 3 so that it causes massive seismic instability anytime you turn the gate on?
It's just a power source.
And you know, things that are unintended consequences are always interesting as well.
Yeah.
Maybe they did something that the unintended consequence of it was that the universe or the Andromeda galaxy is slowly becoming uninhabitable.
Mm-hmm. Well,
that wasn't what they set out to do.
Well, see, that's actually kind of an interesting question because the Romulans who work for Datan concluded that the issue with the gate on Dewa 3 is that it was sabotaged. Probably by the Iconians when they abandoned it on the planet. Because
they didn't want anybody else to use it.
That's what killed off the Daywans. The Daywans reached a technological level where they had figured out how to use the gate. And so they attempted to turn it on. And boom.
Yeah. Well, at that point, the Iconians were being pursued by the interspecies alliance that was trying to exterminate them. So they probably were thinking pretty short term about that. Like, well, the people who are chasing us, well, if they've come into kind of, they find the gateway, they're going to turn it on, and oh, boom, it explodes right in their face. So it's kind of like a continuation of the war, but like an unexploded landmine, it just sort of got left around and hit a civilian target.
Yeah, pretty much.
So Sir Boulevard made up a good point in the chat, and I just went on to Memory Alpha and confirmed it, that Worf in Deep Space Nine actually mentions fighting Kelvin.
Yep.
I had not remembered that.
I didn't either.
Well, see, the group of Kelvins that Kirk encountered presumably created some sort of a colony or something for to live on.
Yeah.
Could have, yeah.
I mean, because they explicitly stated in the episode that they were not going back to the Andromeda galaxy, so they were going to be living somewhere in the Milky Way galaxy. And there was still, I think, like six or so of them. So, you know.
And of course, being aliens, you don't have to worry about inbreeding depression, because it's like, oh, no, they don't worry about it.
well, also that whole inbreeding depression thing only really applies when you don't have the medical technology required to tweak the DNA codes.
It is a big problem, though, in genetics, that if you can kind of do that, you can kind of just do anything, because it's basically you have to rewrite the entire genome.
No. There's actually only certain specific keys that you would need to adjust
across the whole genome.
No.
It is across the whole genome. The reason for inbreeding depression is because of deleterious recessive alleles, and those are just any allele that is basically not maladaptive. And those combine in homozygous combinations, those start affecting. Those can be anywhere.
Right, but that's the sort of thing that I would expect the Federation medical people to have figured out how to purge from the people's genomes as a general matter of practice.
Because we still have humpback whales, so we have to have done it.
Exactly.
Yeah. They didn't. George and Gracie weren't the last ones.
Well, actually, it's something that Dr. Crusher talks about in TNG. It is like with Barclay, in that a case when he got a cold that most people were immune to. And I mean, she'd say, like, oh, well, it's because you have this little genetic thingy here. And she attempted to fix it, and things went hilariously wrong. But
or terrifyingly wrong.
In theory, that sort of thing, you know, it's like the general medicine to them is like fixing genetic defects like that.
I don't know. I mean, it seems like we're
a fun thing that you can go ahead.
I was going to say, it seems like we're already in our current present technology on the cusp of genetic modification. So, I mean, by the time you get around to the 23rd and 24th century, it seems like medical technology would have advanced that much further.
It's advanced enough to where they have to place ethical limits on it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Assuming, though, we didn't lose too much during World War III.
I mean, we still got, obviously, enough. Star Trek's medicine is much further along than ours.
It's also a question of whether or not the Fed is actually developing genetic engineering tech, because there is a strong sort of taboo against eugenics. So it's probably going to be very heavily regulated. And people still age, so that's going to be a symptom of not being able to really prune out the entire genome,
for sure.
But, I mean, we're also talking about the Kelvins, who are obviously not subject to those rules.
Yeah, they don't.
So, Kelvins are still around, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so, back to the original premise here. what Dragoon was tweeting about earlier this week was, you know, the idea of the Enterprise J being like something like a mobile starbase that would travel with a fleet of ships, you know, off on some mission.
Yeah.
And so I was saying to myself, you know, what sort of mission?
Kind of like Mass Effect Andromeda?
A little bit. Which we're all very excited to play.
If you look at this,
a week and a half.
If you look at the Enterprise J, it's like all saucer. I mean, the saucer is like the by far the most dominant aspect of it. And it just made me think, well, I mean, it's kind of Enterprise D in that sense, where it's a ton of extra spaces devoted to like people and families and stuff like that. And so maybe.
And also, it's interesting to think about like the sort of the justification for having a ship that big of like it just creating a really big warp field. So the ship itself doesn't take up much room, but you can put a lot of other stuff in there. So that's where the whole fleet comes in.
Yeah.
Assuming they're not directly attached to the ship.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that sounds a lot like the principle they used in Babylon 5 of why they would have fighters dock with a carrier before doing a hyperspace jump. Because fighters could be made to be capable of doing hyperspace jumps on their own, but carriers just did it better, I guess is the simple way to put it.
It may be, for sure. This is can tie back into Andromeda, but maybe it's that in order to reach a distant place like Andromeda, you need like an advanced transwarp and or slipstream drive. I mean, mm-hmm. if you look at it, it's got this big massive deflector on the front of the saucer. So maybe it's it's got this it's super advanced
sort of
slipstream.
Intergalactic engine.
Yeah. So all the ships get in the, or kind of tuck into the field, and then they ride the slipstream that the Enterprise J creates all the way to this distant location.
Are we creating our next AEI? Because I mean, like once we get those ships in, I mean, what we could do is a sort of anthology where people would be invited to roleplay, bring their 26th century ships in as one of the ships in that fleet. And the missions basically take off on go explore somewhere in the Andromeda galaxy set in the 26th century.
Like the 26th century Chronicles.
Yeah.
So here's what I was thinking of, you know, sort of extrapolating on Dragoon's ideas. One of the things that Daniels is always sort of evasive about is Earth, in where he comes from in the 31st century.
Yeah, you know, it's so there, more or less.
Are you even from Earth? Depends on how you define Earth. And so I'm thinking to myself, you know, what if this process of changing Earth begins in the 26th century? Okay, so... And here's the start of it, is maybe Earth is not where it used to be.
Like maybe I got some, knocked out of orbit or
crazy,
something?
Some crazy, super powerful enemy moves it. Poof. Right before your eyes. And the mission of the Enterprise is J, and its fleet is fine.
Oh, that's pretty fun. That's pretty fun.
Yeah.
We lost Earth. We gotta go find it.
Well, it kind of reminds me of one of the TNG novels where there's this planet that is being threatened by its star having become unstable for whatever reason. And the crew of the Enterprise D has to come up with a way to relocate the planet to a different solar system. And what they end up doing is like creating an artificial wormhole they were able to force it to stay stable long enough for the planet to go through the wormhole. Well, most of the planet anyways. it ended up with a new ocean because the wormhole fluctuated at the wrong time and like sheared off an entire mountain range.
Oops.
Okay.
Another possibility is also Earth becomes sort of more of an artificial habitation and can move itself.
Well, here's a thought.
A world ship.
Yeah.
Let's say we take your scenario of the sun has been threatened. Like maybe somebody attacks, sends in a tri-cobalt. Or what is it, a trilithium warhead into the sun. Mm-hmm. And the Earth has, like, hours to save itself. So what they do is their technology is advanced far enough that they set up a planetary shield to encompass the entire planet to protect it. Unfortunately, they don't have enough time to properly calibrate it, and when the shockwave from the sun hits the shield, it reacts and creates a fold in space, sending it to an unknown location.
Yeah, I like that. You know, that Earth is gone because of some sort of, you know, accident or, you know, we didn't necessarily do things properly or there wasn't time to do things properly and it messed up. And yeah. Oh, Pax says the novel that we were talking about is A Fury Scorned. You must have read that one. So yeah, the mission of the Enterprise J and its fleet is to go to where they think Earth might be near and send out scouting parties to try and find it.
So, I mean, if you did want to do this like an IE or AEI type scenario, maybe you could do like an introductory mission where Earth is lost.
Yeah, this is the opening mission. And then it's like from here, okay, everybody make whatever you want.
Yeah. Yeah, we could also do a Enterprise J crew.
Yeah, because we don't know nothing about them.
Nothing at all. Don't even know the captain.
Well, yeah. Actually,
other than Chekhov.
Isn't it a Dax?
Oh, that's right. It might be a Dax, isn't it?
Yeah, I think there might be a little bit from the fact that it was included.
I'd have to go play Ragnarok again.
I think it might be a Dax. I only
played that once.
So we know it's, but we haven't seen the captain though. So we can make it anything. It's a Dax. It's a Trail symbiote with a Dax in it.
Yeah.
But that's it.
But in any case, that will obviously, this will be for the future. We could do this because they have not put any of these ships that we need in the Foundry just yet. But we do get new ships. We actually just this week with the update got the Atlas in the Foundry. So.
Do we have the Lucari Dorito ship yet?
Actually, I believe we might. But in any case, our next activity is actually going to take us into the Foundry, so we can check. So, Dragoon, if you want to load up the Foundry. One of the things that I thought we could do is since the... And I'm blanking on the names of these ships, but the Klingon and Romulan dreadnoughts, the 26th century dreadnoughts that were just put into the game, do not have custom bridges. They just use the Federation style 26th century. Why don't we try and make one or two? And I think we should start with the Klingon. Just toss a coin. So the question is, how do you make a Klingon bridge and make it futuristic? A good 100-odd years past what we have now. We got plenty of Klingon materials and objects, but the question is, how do you make it look a little bit futuristic? I'm sure we are worthy of this challenge.
I've been thinking about it, and I'm kind of blanking a little bit because
it will
sort
take
of like,
some searching through the object list.
Yeah, because we were thinking about this before, and I know Cryptic said they had some Gothic inspirations for their universe class analog of the KDF. And it does have some pretty smooth flowing lines in addition to some standard styles of KDF architecture. So I'm thinking, naturally, big window starting off.
One of the funny things that they were showing us on the dev stream, which was just last night, was that they actually put a tiny version of the Great Hall from Kronos.
I wonder if
on the hull of the ship.
I wonder if, like, on the flagship, if that actually is the Great Hall from Kronos. They moved it.
That could be a storyline in our missions.
They send the Great Hall to go find Earth.
Yeah, the Klingons actually built a ship around their Great Hall on the planet. And then lifted it off.
Actually, to be honest, if you look at the old Kronos map from way back when, there actually was an exterior map for the Great Hall. And it's really not that big of a structure.
I just want to cut in here. I was just jumping in the Foundry. Gemini has just gotten up to 1,701 ratings. So nice. 1701. 1701. Just looking at it, it's like, wait, okay.
No one else play it ever.
No one. No, it's done. It's done. It's perfect. I should just withdraw it. withdraw so it now.
Primars, Primar says he's also working on one as well. So I'm quite eager to see what he comes up with, and we'll see what we can come up with here. But you know, the thought I had is, what if you made it like almost like the inside of a cathedral?
Yeah.
Big like vaulted ceilings and something.
Yeah, that Klingons do seem to like that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or a temple interior.
I was thinking about recently, especially since you pinged me on Twitter for 26th century KDF uniform. Yeah. I've been thinking about doing that, like how to do that. If I had the Nakul pieces and the Kelvin pieces, I already know, like I've already got a uniform on my Fed or my KDF in-game character that I can't replicate in the Foundry, but that's basically what I'm thinking, like futuristic Klingon. A little just like gothic, but more sort of stylish. So a little bit more, I don't want to say cultured for the Klingons, but sophisticated. Like the great house, like warrior, it's kind of like medieval period. And then it moves on to kind of like a, you know, the Klingons have like a renaissance, like in the 26th century.
I like that. The Klingon renaissance.
Yeah, so especially since it sort of like syncs up with them joining the Federation, that would be part of it. Mm. So they don't necessarily view it as going weak. It's just like recultivating honor. So how to go about doing that. Yeah. So I need the Nakul pieces and the Kelvin pieces, and I could totally just repeat the design. Vondwar, too, would be, you know, great for this. Mm-hmm. But with what there is in the Foundry, I mean, we've got the Karath, but that's a little too late because that's 29th century.
So what we do need to choose here is a base map.
Yes.
The question is, do we want to use any kind of an existing base map, or do we want to make it a full custom job?
I'm thinking full custom job, unless we want to use elements from New Khitomer.
Or elements from the old Great Hall.
Those are really hard. I was just going to say,
I'm wondering, you could build it in the yard in front of the Great Hall and have a window looking back at that Great Hall. Because it's a feature on the ship.
Yeah, that's right.
Say like the bridge is just right in front of that, or maybe this is like a command center. It doesn't have to necessarily be the bridge. Yeah. Maybe this is a big command center.
Ugh, little kitty jumped on the keyboard. little cat's nuts tonight.
So let's try the Great Hall, the old Great Hall exterior.
Yeah,
see where that gets us as a start.
I know the interior loaded up at the moment.
Yeah, I know. Like it can be tricky with the coordinate system. Zero isn't always zero, or where you think it, like where it was previously. So you always have to watch out a little bit with Oh, how you build around that. Oh, God. I'm just thinking like, just that rampway up would also maybe make a good, like very three-dimensional bridge layout there. That would just be hard to work on.
Well, that's why I'm thinking exterior.
Yeah. Now you still got the floaty bits. Yeah, I do like...
Windows
like,
a little messed up. Hang on a sec, guys.
Yeah. The Klingon columns would probably work really well for what we're going to be doing, because I do always like how those were designed, is that they're, you know, they're Klingon, but they're very stylized. I mean, they're kind of going back to looking a little bit more sophisticated. So using those as sort of the like major features on sort of the Gothic map as sort of the major pillars would probably be the way to go. And then maybe putting another object inside those to break up the fact that we're using those.
I know. I mean, running around the Great Hall is kind of good for at least for inspiration.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
it's fun running around the old Great Hall and trying to remember what all the rooms were for back when it was the social hub.
I would always get lost in here.
Primer says you need to rescale the game in the stream UI.
Yep, I just did that.
I do like the Klingon wall lights too. I've been trying to use those a little bit more just because they're like they're really nice, just decorative pieces.
Mm-hmm. So I'm having this vision in my head of the big Klingon statues, which I believe we have
Yep.
As objects. Yep. On either side of the view screen.
Or like lining a hall from behind. So you have to go through this like massive hall to get to the bridge. Yeah. Like walk through among the ancestors.
Okay. That would go with the sort of ridiculously I don't know what the word is.
Grandiose
and epic, overly epic scale of the whole ship, basically. Decadence.
Mm-hmm. Or just very confident imperial power.
Yes.
We will show those humans how to find their own homeworld.
Although, ironically, getting closer and closer to actively joining the Federation.
Well, what was it? There was like all this talk back when Destiny was like first announced, and wasn't there like some talk about it being set in the future and like Klingons being like these sort of monks?
Oh,
Discovery, you mean?
Yeah,
Discovery. I'm sorry.
I honestly don't know.
It'd be an interesting.
I don't remember that. I mean, there's been so many rumors; it's hard to keep track of them.
Yeah.
So many rumors, so little actual information.
That's why I'm just like, I'm just going to wait for episode one.
Yep.
I remember this time when someone posted a picture of, and it's like, hey, I think these things are Klingons, and then people just like go crazy. They're like, no, that's not what Klingons look like. Those are horrible, blah, 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 blah.
They always redesign Klingons.
How dare, how dare they redesign Klingons a fifth time?
It's like, wait, yeah, I mean, it's kind of like it wouldn't be a new Star Trek thing if they didn't redesign the Klingons.
Well, multiple times, maybe.
Yeah, because I mean, we got the motion picture Klingons, and even still, those are a little bit different.
Those are a bit
guide of Next Generation. Yeah, and even still, they went through subsequent iterations, especially for their ship interiors, the movies.
Yeah, like that one ship interior where, for some unknown reason, there's Klingon captain is standing in front of a Federation logo.
Oh, yeah. That was like the first season of TNG where they're just trying to really play up the fact that they're allies or even in various episodes part of the Federation.
Yeah, they were toying with that at first. And remember Wesley's famous line of, oh, was that before the Klingons joined the Federation?
And Picard didn't correct him.
Well, like I said, I mean, you can kind of hand wave it as... he's basically saying before they joined the Federation in an alliance.
Yeah. So,
well,
because it's ultimately,
to be honest, I just hand wave it away as that really makes sense.
I just hand wave it away as, you know, goofy season one stuff.
It's also Picard not really paying attention to Wesley.
Yeah, shut up, Wesley.
It's like yes, whatever, boy. Yes, you're saying something about girls, weren't you? I'm just back in the main game right now. I do really love the fact that you can basically see the new 26th century super ships pretty much from any distance. They don't draw those out when you get it far away.
Makes sense. It's one thing that I always like to do... or not always, but sometimes I like to do, is to use buildings as walls. It gives you a little bit of a different texture from obviously the few default walls that we have. And some of those Klingon buildings that you're looking at could be quite interesting as walls.
Yeah.
And they're nice and big.
Aw, looks like my game crashed on me. That was a weird one because... Oh, nope, never mind. It's the same one that it's been doing.
I know they've seen a couple of patches go out for to kind of help with graphics card crashes. I don't know if any of them had helped you at all.
No.
I've noticed that the horrible extrusion face melting has gone away. Well, I don't want to jinx it because I saw it like happen once a couple days ago. But since the last patch, I haven't had it happen yet. So I'm hopeful that that's fixed. But at the very least, I don't have to worry about like every single map, some new horror striking one of the characters.
That's because you're playing Star Trek Cthulhu Online.
I get to see the darkness seeping out of people's eyes. Literally.
Yeah.
I mean, it's made for some great screenshots.
Well, that kind of reminds me of a weird anomaly I noticed when playing Temporal Ambassador on my TOS character. Is that for the mission, it automatically changes your costume. Well, for some strange reason, in cutscenes, my character's hands looked like they were made of, like, stretched into spaghetti. Almost. It's really strange looking bug.
Cutting it on the stream here. Where you or Dragoon lined up those column style buildings. Not the big ones, but the little ones. Into that flat wall section. I love that for what we're going for.
I know, I was thinking
so the ones on the north end of the map. Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, curving and stuff like that would be good. But I just love the pattern on those guys.
Yeah, I'm thinking I want it to be grandiose, and it means I need more space. So, I mean, we still need like a...
One thing we should definitely have is like fires burning
everywhere. Not like, you know, not an Admiral Aaron level blaze, but
no, I mean like intentional fires.
Yeah, we do. Since we do have those really nice lamp pieces.
Yeah.
To be honest, I think Klingon technology by 2409 has probably advanced to the point where they can make artificial, like holographic braziers so that they don't actually have a real fire burning all the time.
Yeah, I would say it's definitely for 26. I don't know if like 24th century or 25th century ones are just still doing the old style fire because, you know, we're Klingons and we can take real fire. 26th century is like we've moved on.
According to Worf, if you want to do anything, any sort of a Klingon tradition, it has to be a real fire.
It has to be in a cave with real fire and, you know, burning incense.
Yeah.
But he's hanging upside down and slitting your palm.
Yeah. Of course, he's the sort of sentimental traditionalist.
Yeah. But so are the people that built this ship.
Well, I would go with excessively sentimental traditionalist.
Yeah, that's kind of his character through DS9. Mm-hmm. Always talking about the wedding.
And then the other Klingons look at him like, why?
Geez, lighten up, dude.
Yeah, light up, come on.
How awesome would that have been is, you know, have some Klingon character who's, God, lighten up, dude.
Yeah, Martok has a group intervention for Worf.
I'm pretty sure that was the entire thrust of Alexander's point to his father.
Worf, we want you to realize that Klingons who grew up on the homeworld are not this serious about our traditions.
It was also Kern's point to Worf.
I Actually, I just thought of some things. I always used to have this idea in my head that what we see for the Great Hall here in this exterior map is actually not exactly the same. The interior map is not inside it, it's underneath it, but whatever.
That would make sense for the Klingons, just thinking about the military application, where it's basically a big bunker.
Mm-hmm.
So I had a thought, you know, what about a sort of like a central platform like you see on a Star Destroyer bridge and then consoles down kind of below it in pits?
Already on
within
it.
So that the Klingon commander bridge will always be above his
men. The Klingon flagship bridge actually has something kind of like that.
Yeah,
I was remembering the Bortescu bridge a little bit when I was thinking about that.
You have the central platform that the captain sits on. There's one or two BOF stations there, and the rest of them are on a different level below it.
We had the two-tier thing going on too.
Mm-hmm. And it kind of, you know, is reminiscent of the bridge from Star Trek III.
Hmm.
The only blue Klingon bridge ever.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Back when they're, you know, flopping through South, and all of a sudden they mm-hmm. It is funny that after they took that Bird of Prey, they made it more Klingon-y than the Klingons.
Yeah, I know. That was really Star Trek IV has completely changed it around, and now it looks more Klingon.
Yeah, I mean, that's what Kirk, you know, the Kirk and the crew is doing. It's like, why do they? This looks weird to us. It doesn't look like a Klingon bridge. We gotta make it look like a Klingon bridge.
Yeah, well, one thing that I always pondered with that one is that they have Spock on board the ship, and Scotty, and why couldn't they just reprogram the computer to stop speaking Klingon?
I half wonder if Scotty wasn't just, you know, messing around. He's cracking a joke. I mean, it is Star Trek IV.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
I mean,
it's a
comedy.
Well, I meant that when you see Spock inputting all of the little formulas for doing the warp jump for their slingshot effect, he's actually typing on a Klingon keyboard.
Well, Spock's talented like that.
Yeah.
Well, and also, I mean, you know, whenever you see Star Trek episodes and movies and all that, and they go on to an alien ship, they are suddenly instantly able to operate consoles.
Maybe they've got implanted basically the visual equivalent to Babelfish.
Yeah.
Universal Visual Translator.
Yeah, that's one of those... things just like the universal translator, as explained on screen in the two or three times they actually talk about it, is never mentioned to have the ability to translate written text.
That would be useful.
Mm-hmm.
Although they have done some scenes where they like have somebody scan something with a tricorder and more or less do the same thing as the universal translator thing, but it's not like this passive thing where people like automatically know what things are when they look at them.
Okay, I think this is starting to come somewhere.
Yeah, I do like the I still really think the kind of the what's working for best for me right now is just that curving wall in the back.
Hmm. Yeah, because
I'm not sure about the building.
Obviously, you got to flip that one around.
Yeah. I'm thinking, like, you've got those the larger buildings, and for me, I can't really separate those from being larger Klingon buildings. So I'm wondering if you can't, like, duplicate that section of wall and just sort of have it as two little components taking the place where those buildings are.
Okay, so I'm somewhat ahead of you guys, and I can't see what you're talking about.
Oh, I'm just talking about, like, you've got the large Klingon buildings on the south side of the map,
uh-huh,
for the walls there. And those ones, I still can't sort of visually separate those from being big Klingon buildings. So I'm thinking you can either like lower those down to hide the doors.
Oh, you mean on the sides?
Yeah, on the sides. Or just, it's still like those to me just still look like we're building, like it's a Klingon building. But in the back on the north side, you've got that curving wall and that looks fantastic. So I'm wondering if you can't replace the big buildings with the little buildings and maybe even just like, or even overlay where you have the little buildings creating a wall where those doors on the big buildings are popping out. So it looks like those are the access points on the bridge.
That sounds like cool.
Well, yeah, I mean,
yeah, sounds really
I want to play around with it a little bit more. I think if we get the right... the right details on it, it might help.
I'm also wondering, can we've got that gigantic Klingon logo. I'm just wondering at this point, you know, grandiose, very imperial, in the sort of the big building type sense, if we can like incorporate that as a major feature on the map.
Yes.
Like, I'm wondering if like there's a loop big enough where we can, I'm just not sure on the scale on that guy, or at least like build it into the walls might be one thing. Or just like even on the visual display or something.
If I remember right, it wasn't there a giant Klingon logo underneath where he put the curved wall?
Oh, maybe.
It was one of those braziers.
Oh, okay. Hmm. I'm just thinking, you know, just a giant, like building a giant, you know, 30-foot Klingon logo. That's 26th century Klingon.
Oh, that reminds me of one of the interesting things about TOS Klingons versus later Klingons is the color of the logo they used.
What did the TOS ones do?
The TOS Klingon logo was actually had four colors to it.
Then they went all red.
Yeah.
Getting their foreheads back was a massively culturally altering thing.
We don't have to worry about diversity anymore. We just need red.
I'm kind of wondering if maybe the augment virus changed the way they see color. Because one hypothesis that some people have come up with is that Klingons may actually be partially colorblind by human standards.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the reason why they use so much red is that just looks good to them because they don't really see other colors the same way humans do.
Oh, it's such a tiny view screen.
All right, we're just loading up.
Yeah, we don't have any 20-foot view screens that we can add to maps, do we?
No. It still could work out as just sort of like a large bridge officer console somewhere.
Yeah, well, I'm trying to figure out what I'm going to do for the view screen. Maybe I have like three of them placed in series around the curved wall.
Yeah, that would do it.
That'd be cool.
All right.
More and bigger of everything.
Control C, Control V, and then fit. Also, it might be worth considering what species might be in the Klingon Empire by 26th century. Like if any would spin out or more would join in or be conquered.
Actually, one joke that someone made on the forums a while back is what do you get when you have Klingon Orion hybrids?
Be interesting. Now I want to make a character.
Well, one of my characters actually has a bridge officer based on the concept. I took a random alien and just like stuck on a mixture of Klingon and Orion features.
With the small pointed ears, you can actually make, with the standard Klingon now, a sort of Klingon-Romulan hybrid, just out of a stock Klingon now.
Cool.
Where you use the sort of the Blonitores sort of limited ridges on the forehead. I mean, you can do this with human too, but then with the point, small pointed ears, you give them that, and then it's like, oh, Romulan Klingon hybrid.
Well, see, I actually used that same set of forehead ridges on my Orion hybrid.
Yeah, so that sort of opens up the hybrid. Like, you can imagine that the Klingons might be doing more hybridization. So you got Orions, probably, you know, if you think about the Republic, maybe integration with them. So maybe more Romulans and Klingons getting together.
Well, you remember what they said about Caldano, how he had, like, an Enterprise, so they identified the charred corpse as being mostly human, but had bits and pieces of, like, four other species mixed in.
Yeah, so by this time, that's probably going to be pretty common. So a lot of blending together. So maybe even, like, Klingon, Romulan, Orion, not Gorn, but yeah, just a bunch of different species mixed together within most officers. Mm-hmm. So relatively few by this point, maybe even relatively few sort of, you know, pure blood Klingons, as you could, you know, might say.
Mm-hmm. Would be interesting if there were some new races added to the Klingon Empire.
Well, see, this is actually one of those interesting things, is that a Cryptic actually left out, for whatever reason, several races that were in canon associated with the Klingon Empire.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like some of those in Enterprise.
Like the Creosians, for example, were established in several episodes as basically being like a servant race to the Klingons.
Yeah.
What do the Creosians look like?
They look a lot like Trill.
Yeah, there's also one of the, like, there's one of them that we actually have the forehead for in the Foundry Tailor.
Arinthin?
I gotta take a look. I'm just gonna go based on the
Arinthin were another one from Enterprise.
Yeah, it was a freighter. They discovered it, and it's like, oh, wait a minute. The Klingons want to execute these people, but they're nice, so I'm just going to look for the forehead that we have. Since I happen to be right there. And I know it's going
to... If I remember right, that thing with the freighter was because of the fact that they were supposed to give something to the Klingons as their tribute, but they didn't do it, so now the Klingons are hunting them down.
Yeah, it was the... Yeah, it was the Arinthin. Yeah, those are good forehead pieces too. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we could do those as custom aliens. Mm-hmm. At the moment now.
Or another thing is, you know, maybe there's one of the races that are in there now that has a lot more power within the Empire.
Arinthin would be an interesting one to write in, and then maybe like play the Gorn down as being sort of a little bit more beaten down, a little bit more integrated. Mm-hmm. Art is having completely separate by that.
I'm sure this statement will make Sir Boulevard very happy, but you know, maybe the Ferocens have taken a bigger role.
Ooh, I just thought of something that's noteworthy here, is that there is actually a clearly defined in the TV show difference between Trill and Creosians. Because while both of them have that whole thing of the spots on the side of the face that going down the neck in a neat row, in the case of the Creosians, it was established that their spots actually go down and stop at... Well, also, there's like kind of like... Instead of going straight down the sides... There's like a curve down and to meet at the base of their spine. Whereas in the case of Dax, as we saw in that one episode where she goes to Risa, hers go all the way from her head all the way down to her feet. and the Creosians apparently don't.
And we've got the drill leg options too in Stow.
But only for actual Trill. If you have an alien character, you can put Trill spots on their face and neck, but they won't go down any farther than the neck.
Now that was a good way to do that there, Dragoon.
Yeah. Pax is also mentioning that the Creosians were brought up in a couple episodes, one in TNG, and it's not clear whether the TNG ones are intended to be the same species.
Well, actually, they were brought up in two episodes of TNG. One where you actually see them in person, which is what provided that reference for how their spots are shaped differently than that of the Trill. Because, yeah, in Perfect Mate, well, yeah, that's what you were talking about. So it's not clear if it's Mindsai and Perfect Mate are meant to be the same race, but the race seen in Perfect Mate is apparently meant to be the same race as the one seen in Star Trek Enterprise.
Yeah. So, yeah, so I think we can safely, at the very least, safely assume that there's a connection, because it hasn't been specifically refuted by anything, too.
Also, it's not entirely clear the exact nature of their relationship with the Klingons, because if you think of the Klingon Empire as being like a feudal a sort of kingdom, you have the Shogunate and you have those other lesser powers that bow to the Shogunate. But the lesser powers, it's not what aren't necessarily treated as slave labor, because like with the case with the Irin Sin is that the Irin Sin had their own fleet of ships, and the Klingons told them, it's like, okay, this is what you have to do, it blah, blah, blah. And
they're basically running an imperial taxation. So they're just showing up there every now and again to collect tribute from the various members of their empire, at least when we're dealing with these guys.
Which that's the way vassal states worked in a feudal setting, is that, you know,
you had the
Klingons were in part based on samurai, yeah. You know, when it got up to TNG or
so you might imagine that this system evolving on to maybe greater integration, where the vassal states are sort of more incorporated into a government, at least by 26. It's questionable whether or not this has happened by 25. So we got those guys from Enterprise. I'm just thinking, is there anything that we could recognize from, say, that we can sort of infer from maybe Undiscovered Country and then the one episode that Archer goes to Repente? Any of those species?
There's a number of different species that you see on Repente.
Yeah.
And Marta was the most interesting.
And some of those could be from Klingon
vassal states, just like, because they are all presumably within the Empire.
Because see, one of the things that was interesting about Marta is that while she's a shapeshifter, that specific race of shapeshifters is never mentioned again. Even though presumably it's a somewhat well-known race, simply because of the fact that when someone said Cameloid, they're like, oh, so that kind of reaction.
Yeah, and maybe they, I was thinking for those ones is that maybe they're a little bit easier to detect, technologically, but they can sort of mimic for, you know, person-to-person contact, different shapes and forms.
Well, yeah. my thought with Cameloids is that maybe it was one of those things where if you had a tricorder, which unfortunately Kirk's friends didn't, that that was actually one thing that I kind of just thought of, is that when they're discussing in Deep Space Nine how to tell the difference between changelings and humanoids, there's certain measures that they discuss that don't work on changelings, and you're just kind of like, okay, so why did they specifically mention those things?
They might work on the cameloids.
Yeah. I mean, like, well, one of them was basically just like to do a tricorder scan of the internal structure of the a person. Well, also that was probably something that they would do in cases like Thelev, where you have someone who has undergone extensive surgical reconstruction to pass as a different individual. Because Thelev from the original Journey or Babel conference episode was actually an Orion. It's just that he had been surgically altered to look like an Andorian.
Yeah. Interesting with cameloids, to try to like weave them into Imperial intrigue. Like in the Empire, if they're used more for underhanded tasks.
Well, I could easily visualize them having a similar status in the Klingon Empire as the Vendorians do with the Romulans.
Yeah.
I could see, like, you know, your richest, most powerful Klingon houses having a cameloid on in their employ for subterfuge.
Mm-hmm.
I'm now wanting a Klingon anthology.
This is kind of a deep rabbit hole you've gone down.
I have long wanted a Klingon TV show, but actually I think it should go the other way and depict the time of Kalis.
Ooh. Lord of the Rings style.
No, not Lord of the Rings style.
I'm just thinking of just like big
Spartacus.
Epic.
Spartacus, yeah. Or 300 style.
Yeah, you know? Like something just the big
slow motion, ridiculous, you know, bloody limbs chopping off and, you know, all kinds of, you know, gratuitous violence.
That is perfectly consistent with Klingons, yeah.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Especially ancient Klingons. Mm-hmm. And then you could, you know, tell those myths that Worf's always telling, and it doesn't have to be realistic, because, you know, you're telling stories. This is ancient mythology.
Yeah, it's said like a old drunken Klingon just stumbles into a bar, starts to, almost kind of like, what was it?
No, just have Worf do it.
Or as an old drunken Klingon stumbling into a bar. The whole thing. Or no, Michael Dorn narrating it to another, like his grandson, or just like reset it as Rushenko or Alexander in Princess Bride style.
That sounds like a good one.
I wonder if you could. It would take a lot of map transitions, but even just like do this in the Foundry.
The only problem with telling. And Pax has been working on a episode or a mission like this about ancient Klingons, and it's something that I had wanted to do because I've had this idea. But my stumbling block was that we don't really have good melee mobs in the Foundry, and you would want a lot of melee combat.
Yeah,
you would want to be able to say to the player, "Okay, grab your Batleth and just and play this mission and just wade on in there."
Ah. Yeah, it's. Because
you
want
it to be like, you know, it's a sword and sandal epic, like 300. You know,
mm-hmm.
That's worth.
I think a book is probably your best bet. I think it would be a tough sell as a TV show.
Yeah. Well, obviously they don't. You know, someone should pay me to like sit in a room and just think up TV shows and then have them and then, you know, give them to people to actually make. I'm an idea person.
Very least you could try just writing as a series of Foundry short stories.
Well, the stumbling block remains is that we don't have good melee mobs.
Keep asking for the, melee only field. Although, yeah, we don't have.
I'm always told that it's exploitable somehow, and I don't quite understand how, because it would seem like it would work the same as animals. Yeah, you could, you know, you could put the player up high and they could shoot them and they can't fight back, but, you know, you can do that with animals now.
Do animals count for accolades, though?
Yes.
That
yes, yeah. There is actually one for killing a certain number of animals.
Ah, okay.
Maybe it's because the field would, like, break any NPC groups not designed for melee.
Well, Pac says that his missions are going to have an explanation for why the ancient Klingons have modern weapons. So he's going to explain it away. That works.
Well, there's nothing to say. We don't know how long Klingons have had energy weapons.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean,
the time of Kalis was only like 1,500 years before TNG anyway.
I would actually
that's not a whole lot of time.
That's the Klingons acquired the ability to use beam weaponry probably pretty close to the time that they acquired the ability to use warp drive.
Yeah. And I always speculated that they always got that from the Herc.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, has been watching anything I've been doing?
I've been trying.
It's quite interesting.
Obviously,
you're trying to get the right height, but yeah, it's a cool thing.
Because I got to sync the view screen content.
That front wall quite interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. I do like the fact where the larger just sort of the Klingon pillars is that I've found that they kind of go a lot pretty well with a lot of different factions. I use them for Ferengi, mixed with the Cardassian walls.
Yeah, I mean, I've been using those cells.
Might
kind
move
of a,
it a little. Might move that whole wall section a little bit further ahead of the command platform, just to give just a tad bit more space there.
Yeah, I do like how that's working out right now,
mm-hmm.
Especially with let's see. I see. So you've got that one console in the middle where you've put that Klingon logo a little further back. I do like that one.
Yeah. That's quite what I was going for, but it seemed to work out pretty well.
Yeah, it really seems like, you know, right now where it is, it seems like like if you've got that focal console kind of with that little visual indicator, and then you've got those supplemental ones too.
Yeah.
Probably going to have to send send a screenshot of the finished product to Ambassador Kale, since I think he would appreciate a 26th century Klingon bridge.
Apparently, Idris Elba has lost out as for the Best Villain Award at the Kids' Choice Awards. Lost to Kevin Hart in The Secret Life of Pets. I'm going to guess probably because the kids couldn't understand what he was saying. I had a little trouble with some of that dialogue myself. Very thickly accented, almost to the point of gibberish.
Mm. You don't have like any Klingon hologram consoles.
I don't think we do.
No, you could cheat with science consoles placed just underneath.
Hmm.
Primer says probably because the kids didn't go see it. Well, you know, box office numbers weren't great.
versus the number who went to go see a bunch of pets. Sounds about right.
Yeah. We're talking a kid's movie versus a non-kid's movie as well. So. Of course a kid's movie is going to win a Kid's Choice Awards.
Well, surprised it's even in the running then.
Yeah. Well, I liked Beyond in general, but I don't know. There's some things about it that just don't sit right with me, and it's hard to even pin.
It's kind of that thing of like there's a lot in Into Darkness which I can definitely say, oh, I hate that. But in Beyond, it's like I liked it. It's just that it's like it's just not balanced right, and with a little tweaking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's almost kind of like you just say, like kind of send it back to the editing and script writing. It's like just try that again, just differently.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a note that you absolutely hate to get as a creative person.
Yeah, like
because it tells you nothing.
Yeah, it's just like there's just a lot of pieces, and personally, it's just sort of like it. Yeah, again, it's just like there's nothing that's particularly wrong. Like, and I do really like the Yorktown aspect, like setting that up.
I mean, that's a very cool. It's a very cool looking station for sure.
Yeah, and where I sort of fit with stuff Beyond is that it really kind of feels like it's a good Star Trek pilot, or a solid, and not necessarily good, but a solid pilot. Where it's like you could go do stuff with this. But in itself, it's just like, it's not the complete thing. Because, I mean, Kirk's got some stuff going on. Like, the characters have got stuff going on. Mm-hmm. And it's like, oh, they're finally introducing some new aspects, some new aliens, some new depths, some new backstory to the universe.
Yeah.
Good Federation designs. And I think a better balance on action, especially when it comes to, like, generic red shirt deaths. Because feel like...
I will say, of all the JJ movies, it's the one I enjoyed the most.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's funny because I actually put it last.
Really?
Well, one thing I noticed about it is that even though they had a lot of red shirts, you're going to call them that, die, it's not like they were like tossed in for shock value. It's like, oh, God, the ship is getting ripped to pieces. And there were most of the crew.
Yeah, and I think the only thing is like the torture scenes throughout, those were where I thought it was just like, okay, that's pushing it. Because they're just not really doing a whole lot except establishing like the bad guy's a bad guy. Well, you can do that through other ways too, besides like, I'm just going to be a jackass. And I think the
for one thing, the bad guys were far more interesting in Into Darkness than the first one.
Yeah, I really love the Klingons in Into Darkness. I mean, just even though they weren't really the bad guys, I mean, they just had, that was a really greatly, well-staged action. That was, interesting to bring in that third faction for the movie. I think with the Beyond guys, like, I always thought, it would have been interesting if the tech wasn't just this sort of bioweapon, is that if it was proto-Borg. And that the plot of the movie was more about Krall finding it, and basically finding that he infects himself with it. Doesn't create a collective, but it just sort of links them with other people. And they start forming sort of more of a political movement. And it was really about the frontier pushing back rather than a revenge plot, which we just had.
and also, as people pointed out, in some ways that revenge plot didn't make a whole lot of sense just because... He's upset because Starfleet isn't killing enough people. I didn't really understand what he was really upset
because
about.
Because it's referencing a whole lot of stuff.
It started as
Like it makes a little bit more sense if you know that he's a Mako, and that's like okay, I get that reference, but it's not in the movie though. So the thing that makes the plot make a little bit more sense isn't actually in the movie, which isn't a very good movie.
that's not good.
Yeah, that was my whole thing with Into Darkness. Is like, I don't think I would understand what's going on here if I didn't see Wrath of Khan first.
One thing that I just thought of is that when you have movies with villains being dicks just because they want to be dicks, Nothing can top the way that went in. Crap! I just blanked out on the name.
All right, are we going in a generally good direction?
I like the consoles down low. I think maybe the wider ones, because there's a lot of space there. So I think that maybe the longer consoles, or double those up. That would be good. The consoles in the back,
leaving space might be a good thing.
I actually can't see it right
Accentuate.
Now. Somehow on mic, and it decided that the stream is offline.
So it might be two eyes, just refreshing that.
I don't know about the platforms down low, because I think, yeah, leaving that open, the floor space more open, it would be a really cool thing. Maybe even have, what about, so what's going on right directly below the platform? You've got still those generator pieces?
Yeah, it's a console group, and I might change it out for just a straight generator.
I'm thinking maybe, what about one of those platforms? Like, have the platforms, go directly underneath. So you've got a workspace directly under the commander.
Yeah, I think the only problem is that I can't raise the, ramp, it can only go so high.
Well, I'm thinking of the
I'm
just move those the console, the platform groups that are taking up, just sort of set to the side, move those closer in.
I just thought of something you could do with those ramps. You could take three of that asset and kind of stack them almost like a house of cards sort of thing.
I think right now, the overall height of the ramp is good because it lines up really well with the consoles up ahead. So you'd have to progressively keep raising the whole map. So I'm thinking of those large platforms that are sort of taking up the space in the floor area. Move those into this, it basically flush with the ramp. So you're losing one of the faces on the consoles, but everything else is just sort of coming in. So there's a workspace directly under, right by the commander. Where he's basically shouting down at people, down directly below, directly ahead. So get as many people working in close proximity or with the commander. So flush with the ramp, and then maybe even directly, sort of flush with the ramp, and then up below that circular piece.
Klingons do love to shout.
Okay, anyways, the thing I was talking about is that flesh Gordon. When you have villains who like to be evil just for the sake of being evil, that's pretty much the stereotypical one.
Emperor from Star Wars.
Yeah, and personally for writing, it's just there's better ways to show evil intentions, except he's just hurting people, because that's kind of the basic one. And he's you can hurt people directly by shooting them, stabbing them, or draining their life force, or you can be planning to do really bad things that fit more naturally with motivation, not just psychopath, but hey, this person has motivations of his own that make sense to this person, but they're not really considering how this is going to be affecting other people. Which is more sort of authentic villain rather than Saturday morning cartoon villain.
Well, that you do actually see people like that in real life, though. Usually they're not in charge of countries, but sometimes.
Sometimes.
Yeah. But those kind of make better sort of villain for a murder mystery rather than a space opera. Because you can sort of play that out. It's sort of if you do it sort of in the open, hey, this is what I'm doing. It's you kind of got to be careful, because then it might simplify the sort of the antagonistic to just be, this person is someone I need to shoot right now.
Well, see, part of the storytelling that I've seen with some implementations of the psychopath version is that it's not so much that the person started out as a total psychopath. It's that once they came into power, they decided to indulge themselves in whatever, and ended up slowly becoming more and more psychopathic over time because, well, they could do whatever they wanted, and that's kind of what they wanted to do.
Yeah, so it's kind of like a final culmination moment when you actually have that. Like they just that lashing out. It's like, oh, where we thought we had a carefully constructed personality, we just have a psychopath.
So, Dragoon, as we're going through this, don't forget to have at least a little space somewhere for our ridiculous, gaudy statues.
Well, see, well, in the case of me...
I was going to say, what I wanted to do was have a hallway leading back here. And I realize you're a few seconds behind me, but leading to the back of the bridge, and then just have a hallway back here with lining with statues, like the Great Hall.
Oh, like the south end of it? That'd be a good place for that, yeah.
That could work, too.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm just, I'm not sure about the those platforms anymore.
The ones set that into the ramp?
Yeah, it's like I would
it
always
was your idea.
Well, I would I wanted those to be sort of moved flush with the ramp, but sort of in terms of their orientation, but more closer to, or you closer or right underneath the circular platform. So not like halfway, but like where most of the space is, because it seems like it'd be hard to move around where those are right now.
Well, that's kind of the point, like, is that you kind of got to go over the ramp in order to get to the sides of the bridge.
Oh, okay. So, what about like adding some pillar, like a pillar, to close in that space between those the generator group and the ramp group? So it doesn't feel like you have to try squeezing around.
You mean like right here in this little gap here?
Let's see. We're still a few seconds behind. Yeah. So right now you're moving down the ramp, and then, I think you're indicating that, that's it's at the base of the ramp. You have the railing go down, then you have that generator group, and then you're moving through it. Yeah, I think you've got that space. So closing off that space, I think, would then sell that idea. So either moving the ramp,
we've got some room to move the ramp contact. Back.
Yeah.
And I need to stand to raise up all the consoles.
We are actually about at our time limit here. I know Dragoon always likes to go and tinker with these maps after we're done with them, so we'll let him do that. This was fun.
Yeah, and I think we've got just a really good really good start for this type of map. The view screen area is I think that's done. I think it's like now it's the rest of the space.
Anyway, I did have one more thing I wanted to say. Such, Ming the Merciless actually did have a well-constructed personality. It's just that he just didn't care what anyone else wanted. It's like, I'm in charge. Screw you.
Yeah, and that can be a good villain.
Can be.
Well,
all right, Dragoon, if you want to put up our contact information.
Okay. All right, we can be reached by email at foundryroundtable@live.com. We're also on Twitter at foundryroundtab. Drogyn can be reached at Drogyn1701. Duncan can be reached at Gorgonops_SSF. And beware following him, because he will flood your feed with pics of his latest characters.
I must share the madness.
Mark can be reached at Markhawkman, and I, of course, can be reached at Greendragoon.
All right. Well, thank you for joining us, and maybe next time we'll start in on a 26th century Romulan bridge. Who knows? But for now, we will say goodnight.
Goodnight.
Goodnight.